Welcome, everyone, to Raising Indiana, our weekly podcast on the life and times of Little Indy. Every happiness and hardship, every adventure and challenge, you'll hear about them here, as well as our conversations with pet experts and people we meet on our travels. Tonight, we continue our conversation with Dr. McConnell and cover such topics as separation anxiety and two of her books, The Other End of the Leash and Love Has No Age Limits. Dr. McConnell, unlike my other three peers who I never kennel train, I'm doing that with Indiana this time. And while he's doing a lot better now, he still gets separation anxiety. And you have a book called I'll Be Home Soon. What are your suggestions to new puppy parents on how to work through this issue?
Well, the first thing I'd say is everybody should work on preventing it from occurring in the first place. It's not uncommon. Dogs are social species, and so being alone can be very distressful to them. And it happens with lots of puppies, but it also happens with older dogs, especially dogs from shelters and rescues for whatever reason. So prevention is easy. Is it basically, yay for you for starting with some kennel training. Basically, and I'm doing this right now, by the way, with my little Tootsie, my little rescue new dog. So she goes into her crate. And I put in something wonderful, some kind of wonderful food. My favorite is some kind of a stuffable toy like a Kong. Put some really great food in there, and I'll put that in the crate and then shut the door and walk away, making sure she's really attending to the food. You can also take a handful of kibble and just sort of toss it inside and let it scatter all over. And before, here's a key, before they're done, you open the door and tell them they can come out now. And they look at you like, yeah, but I'm not really done. You say, no, you can come out now. So basically it's a kind of reverse psychology where rather than being like, let me out, their reaction when you come to open the gate is like, oh, no, I'm fine here. And you're conditioning them classically to feel good inside the crate while you walk away. So gradually over time, you just leave them in there for longer and longer periods, especially with puppies. You put them in there when you know they're sleepy. You know, we all know the puppy off-on switch. And so put them right before the off switch is about to engage. So prevention is critical. For treatment, obviously, it's a longer answer. A good answer, Luke, is longer than we would have time for. But basically treatment is somewhat similar in that you are conditioning them to associate your walking away, whether it's them in the crate or you leaving the house, with feeling good. And the key to doing this correctly is to understand that you're working with the first few seconds of your leaving. So dogs with full-blown separation anxiety, for example, start getting distressed, before you go, right? I mean, they know the signs. They know when you're leaving. So you go in the bathroom to brush your hair. You put on your jacket, and they start panting or pacing or looking nervous. They're already nervous. So that's where you actually have to start. You have to start with the first steps of leaving. So I've worked with clients' dogs who we conditioned them. We would put down a toy with food in it or throw kibble on the floor, and they just put on their jacket, and that's all they do. And then they take their jacket off and take the food away. And they do that 10 times in one evening. And then you work your way up to going partway to the door, and then you work your way up to putting your hand on the doorknob but not actually leaving. And it sounds so tedious. And the first steps, frankly, they are tedious. But the good news is once you go through those first steps, once you can get outside the door and the dog's still like, I haven't even noticed you're gone. I don't care. I'm busy eating food. I don't care. I feel fine. Then you can be outside for a minute and then 5 minutes and then 20 minutes and then an hour and then 2 hours and then three and then eight, or hopefully not that long, but you get the idea. It usually takes, with acute cases, if you have time to do it ideally, it usually takes 4 to 6 weeks to turn a dog around. But with some dogs, it can take a lot longer. I've had clients' dogs who needed 6 to 9 months to really get it turned around. But that's rare. But anyway, that's the key. There's a lot more details in I'll Be Home Soon, but that's the key to getting it to work.
You know, I've frozen a Kong and put it in his kennel, but I never thought about the reverse psychology of taking him out prematurely. Wow, what a great idea. We'll definitely try that. Now, you have a book and blog entitled The Other End of the Leash, and that's something I find myself obsessing over constantly, is how Indiana perceives me. Tell us about the book.
Well, the book is about the book is basically a comparison of the behavior of the animals at both ends of the leash, dogs and humans. So I compare the way we see the world, I compare the way we respond to it, the way our social sort of culture is, what genetics tells us to do. So a lot of it's very similar. You know, we're both very social species. We both love to exercise. We love to go on walks. We love to play. We share so much, but we don't share everything. You know, dogs don't naturally walk down the street shoulder to shoulder with a friend. And we don't even think about it. You don't have to teach somebody. You don't have to teach little children to walk side by side with a friend of theirs. They do it naturally. And most higher primates do it naturally, as a matter of fact. But dogs don't. You know, you don't go to a dog park and see two dogs who are friends walking at the same pace, shoulder to shoulder. So we have to teach them, for example, to heel beside us. And that's a natural to them. It's like a circus trick. So that's what the book's about. It's about the animals at both ends of the leash and how understanding how dogs see the world can enrich your relationship with them.
Your latest book is near and dear to my heart, as throughout our walk, I would stop at the local shelter and help out for a day. And you know, Indiana was adopted out of Kentucky, in Bowling Green, Kentucky, as a matter of fact. Why is Love Has No Age Limit so important to you?
Oh, thanks for asking, because it's near and dear to my heart, too. I really appreciate you asking. It was sort of a labor of love from my co-author, Karen London, and I. As behaviorists, we saw so many people who adopted dogs from shelters and rescues with the best of motivations and getting some wonderful dogs, but there was a bit of a disconnect in that there isn't a book out there that talks about bringing a new dog into your house that's not a puppy. You know, what if they're adolescent? What if they're 7 years old? So we found that people were having behavioral problems with their dogs that didn't need to happen as long as they had a manual, an owner's guide, to bringing an older dog into your house. And so we wrote the book for two reasons. One was to encourage adoptions, because there's so many great dogs out there. We couldn't agree with you more, Luke, and yay for you with this project you're doing and stopping in at shelters. There's so many wonderful animals out there who need homes who don't have them yet. So we wanted to encourage adoptions, but we also wanted to encourage smooth transitions and decrease the number of dogs who are returned, because that does happen. And one research project in one part of the country actually found a 30% return rate. And not because the dogs had serious, severe behavioral problems. Of course, some of them do, but it was more often something like, for example, one of the things we talk about in the book is how even if you bring home a three-year-old dog, you have to treat it like a puppy in regards to house training for the first couple of days, if not the first couple of weeks, because it's a new house to them. They're not thinking like you're thinking. They're not thinking like, oh, I was trained in one house not to go, and now I'm going to another house, and my training related to all houses everywhere, no matter what they look like or smelled or anything. So we had all these clients who would adopt dogs from shelters, and they saw in the evaluation that dog was house trained, so they brought him back and paid no attention to the dog. And then it went and urinated in the guest room three times, and now all of a sudden we have a bad habit, and they're in to try and fix the bad habit. So that was the goal, to eliminate problems like that. And it's been so gratifying. We got donations from the printers, from the graphic artists. We got people all around the country to send in pictures of their rescued dogs, and so all the pictures in the book are rescued dogs. And we're able to sell it basically at cost if it's bought in bulk. A lot of people are buying it and donating multiple copies to their shelters so that the shelters and the rescue groups can hand the booklet to every new dog owner to try and smooth the transition. And we've had wonderful feedback. I'm just all oxytocin-y about feeling really good about what the feedback we've got about it so far. So it's a feel-good project, and I hope it helps a lot of dogs out there.
That's wonderful. Now, are you working with shelters because, again, being in so many that I know that they're often overwhelmed and they have sort of a fire-and-forget approach. They adopt out a dog and don't do any sort of follow-up, and the return rate is so high. So is it your hope maybe that long-term you'll be working closely with shelters to reduce that, to get that return rate down?
That's exactly the motivation for writing this book is exactly that, is to reduce that return rate as well as encouraging adoptions. But, yeah, you know, I've worked with shelters a lot, and I have seen that problem a lot, and I've seen it on the other side with the clients who come here. So that's exactly what it's for. And so far we've gotten good feedback that it seems to be doing that. So cross your paws, because I think so many of the returns are really truly about people honestly not knowing how to transition, what to do that first month when you bring a new dog into your house.
That's all the time we have for part two with Patricia McConnell. A ton of thanks to her. And, folks, you got to look forward to part three. We want to thank our listeners, friends, and fellow dog lovers from Sheila, Hudson, and Indiana and me. Keep the faith and puppy up. And, folks, support your local shelter or rescue and learn more about canine cancer at 2milliondogs.org.